very much. Wow, that was the most rousing welcome one could ever get. This is fantastic. I can feel the energy in this room today. It's heaving, building up some kind of momentum. Wonderful to be here. Thank you so much to Richard for inviting me. Where's Richard? He's hereabouts? There he is. Uber mensch, fabulous gentleman. Thanks so much. And because we are friends and collaborators, and he was so gracious the other evening at our welcome dinner, to be able to just pay some due deference to design in Darwin, and it was part of the inspiration for what design could do. So, you know, what can Africa do for Europe? Maybe. I think also to say that when we chatted about the presentation, I said to Richard, it's, you know, we've been going around for 21 years, as this gray beard attests to, and maybe it's less interesting to talk about design in Darwin because it's really reasonably well documented. But the thing that's really exciting me at the moment, and I'm stuff that I'm, you know, have goosebumps about, is traipsing around Africa, and I'm a veteran now of about 34 of the 54 countries, and like I'm the primary witness to some of the most amazing things that is happening across Africa in terms of creativity. So I prevailed upon Richard, and he conceded, and I said to him, why don't we just curate an insert into the program? So the next hour and a half is less about us, meaning like design in Darwin, but more about peers and friends and colleagues that we've met on our creative safari across Africa. So quickly, just to give you some context, as Richard insisted I do, I started a company called Interactive Africa. We have a one-word strategy document, just one word, and the word is stretch. We want to shift the algebra in Africa from lowest common denominator to highest possible multiple, to say to Africa, end with sloppy compromises. Let's just get up there and have big, hairy, audacious goals. So we tried to live up to that creed in terms of big, hairy, audacious goals. We did this rally in 1999, logistically demanding, northern tip of Africa, southern tip of Africa. In 1999, there were more phones in Manhattan than all of Africa. And we were saying that if you want to entrench democracy, you want to promote commerce, people need to talk, it's a basic human right. And with a Canadian NGO called IDRC, we built telecenters along the way and gave telephony to people who hadn't heard a dialing tone before. And we did this massive campaign in English, French, and Arabic that said to the world, Africa missed the Industrial Revolution. Don't let it miss the Digital Revolution. We project managed this trip in 2002. If you ever want to find out about it, it's at africaninspace.com. We did this with the Russians, fabulous South African entrepreneur, started a business in his garage, sold it to VeriSign in 2001, for $575 million. Now that's a kind of peculiar thing about Africa. I mean, it constantly serves up surprises. Who would have thought that a kid, an entrepreneur, a technologist in a bedsit in Cape Town could sell his company to VeriSign for $575 million. Anyway, he was kind enough to buy his ticket to space, but on the back of which we launched this amazing campaign, which still exists, to promote math, science, and technology with the youth in our country. You see, apartheid education had systematically removed maths and science from the curricula of black children in our country in a deliberate dumbing down exercise. So we almost used this massive campaign with the South African flag on the fuselage of a Soyuz as it blasts off from Baikonur in Kazakhstan. And on the back of it, when everyone's galvanized and watching on a Pan-African satellite bouquet, watching the live links with Mandela talking to the cosmonauts, we presented this proposition that last century it was good enough to be literate. This century, you have to be techno-literate. The bar's just been raised. It's hip to be square. And we were very involved in South Africa's bid for the Soccer World Cup. We were at Ground Zero. We did something quite stupid, which I wouldn't do anymore, but you put it down to youthful impetuosity. We venture capitalized it. We lent them an unsecured loan that got the bid up and running, and we traipsed around the world as part of the lobby for the Soccer World Cup. It's so important, and I think the most important thing, it was a silver lining in an otherwise economic cloud in the country in 2010. You know what it was post-2008. You all talked about the crisis here, and this was the silver lining, but more than anything else, what it did for us is it was wonderful for our confidence. It was just so gorgeous for our morale. And I think we all need that. We need that in business, we need that in creativity, we need courage, and I think more than anything else, you sat for an exam, the biggest intergalactic event of all time, and you passed the exam, and I think it did wonderful things for us. But this is the program that is my absolute baby. I adore it. I love it. This is the motto for it every single day. I'm an incurable romantic about it. And I am kind of still this inveterate optimist that believes the best day is ahead of us in terms of this platform. But in 1994, at the dawn of our democracy, I was kind of concerned that the entire discourse was being led by economists and was led by policy wonks. And so we thought, well, how about extending the scope of what Africa could be or what South Africa could be? Let's galvanize an alternative army. And so we put together an army of the ponytailed, the pierced, the tattooed. We brought together a creative army. And we said to this creative army, help us reimagine Africa. Help us inspire a whole new generation of Africans who are going to realize that the real gold is not to be mined 3 kilometers below Johannesburg. The real gold is walking on the streets of Johannesburg. And really, for the first time in our lives, let's start to invest in human capital. Let's start to understand that the prime real estate is actually here. And let's mine ideas. And this was the platform, and this is what we thought we should do. And the whole motivation for it, and you can see from that kind of activist background, the whole motivation was, how can we reimagine Africa? How can we see a better world through creativity? And it's been amazing, and I think there has been, and we are witness to in the last 21 years, a bit of a creative revolution going on. And I think a critical part of it has been a progressive framework, a progressive constitution. And we recently had to upbraid our kleptomaniac president by dragging him in front of the Constitutional Court, which is so darn important. But this is the kind of stuff, the values that are enshrined in our society, that gives us the possibilities to be able to go out there and express ourselves. On a social level, we have the best ingredients, one of the most diverse societies in the world. And this heterogeneity is the lifeblood of creativity. Here we are, black, white, colored, Asian, man, woman, Christian, Muslim, Jew, Hindu, animist, atheist, gay, straight, disabled, all equal and enfranchised in the new South Africa. And more than anything else, that's what sparks creativity. So we have this gig. It goes up to about 45,000 people who assembled in Cape Town in the last week of February. You're all invited for 2017, last week of February. And this is the spectacle that it is. And I'll just give you a little taster in case you have no perspective of what the design endeavor is. I'll give you a little taster. We just hastily put this together. This is not the official video, but just something hastily put together for you. Volume, please.
Welcome to the 21st Design Endava Conference for this very special birthday year. After a 10-year hiatus, we are back in the Artscape Theater.
I'm pumped. I'm inspired. There's things I haven't seen before that I'm going to start applying in my designs. I'm ready to get to work and start using the knowledge that I've learned.
It's just been such a fabulous experience to be here for 3 days. It's been a real festival of ideas and idealism, and for me, a really much needed, a very important sort of top up of optimism.
It's just a lot of electricity and explosion of fun and great ideas.
I really feel like I'm a 100% South African. That's where I belong.
Thank you, thank you, thank you. You're a wonderful audience.
I've been waiting to come for many, many years. I never imagined my first visit would be to a design conference as a chef. Imagine.
People were asking me, so what are you up to? Are you a designer? Are you an artist? What do you do? And I'm like, I don't care. I'm just a creative person.
I'm really impressed by this event. I'm sure that when I get home, that everything that I've seen and heard, it will influence our work in the future.
It inspires innovation more than anything for me. It's on another level, and the speakers are just...
Good architecture could have the diversities or allow people to choose, not defining the spaces by the functions.
It's just it's superficial.
No question, you have to come to the Design Endava. It has to happen. People talk innovation all the time. They have to come and see how innovation actually happens.
The opportunity for us to sort of turn storytelling into something that can powerfully change the world and do something to actually create the disruption that it needs is kind of in all of our hands right now.
Thank you to the team who like worked with me every night for the last 3 nights till 1 in the morning here. Thank you to you.
If you haven't been here, why not? I think the point of this event for South Africa is that you realize when we're standing here that it's actually a showcase to the world as well at what we're doing on ground level.
It is all about building systems that foster, deepen, and encourage relationships to happen. So I think that it is through designing in relationships that we can really change our world.
I come back to Design Indaba because it energizes me. It energizes me to see how creative people are, how they're wanting to change the world.
See you tonight.
See you tonight.
Cheers.
I keep coming back because it's a sensational exploration of amazing concepts, amazing ideas, an incredible networking opportunity to meet people who come from all walks of life.
Creativity is about living, breathing, and thoroughly, totally, amazingly innovating in Africa, about Africa, for Africa, for the world.
Okay, so you're invited next year. But I mean, I thought we'll create a mini Design Indaba experience for you today. But just into being able to tell you how we do this, it's in the making that makes a difference. We try to really crank it up for Africa. I think all too often, Africa has just been getting served a dilute. We really want to serve Africa a concentrate. Only the best must do for Africa. And we have that particular ethos in how we manage it. So Imogen was presenting this year, and she developed this wonderful glove, which by gesture you make music. So she was always this kind of hyperkinetic performer that would run across the stage. And then she worked with some interaction designers to develop this glove. And when we met her and we said to her, well, how are we going to do this talk? And then we subsequently realized that it needs to be galvanized into a massive concert, which we did with the Cape Town Philharmonic Orchestra, but importantly with a youth choir from Khayelitsha, average age 16 years of age. So in the making, it becomes developmental, it touches so many more people, and these youngsters of 16 get to perform with a Grammy Award-winning artist. This was a talk we had this year. Fabulous young architect, just beautiful work. Remember his name, Thomas Chapman, wonderful kid. He only works in the inner city of Johannesburg. He was working for a design practice. He was building homes for rich people. He says, enough of that. He started his own practice. It's in inner city Joburg. And when I met him, he showed me this one wholesome project about building a new center for jazz remembrance in Sophiatown. Now, Sophiatown is a magical place in our history. In the 60s, it was the hotbed of creativity, where mixed race people of mixed race, the races intermingled in Sophiatown. Miriam Makeba was there, Hugh Masekela was there. It was just fabulous. But of course, it was an eyesore for the apartheid government, so they demolished it. And Thomas crowdfunded, and together with some lottery money, created this beautiful center for jazz remembrance. And so when we met him and we invited him to come and speak to Design Indaba, he says, oh, I'm disappointed. I says, what's wrong? That looks lovely. And I heard it's got a great program and you have a jazz musician installed in there. What's the issue? He says, well, I wasn't able to finish my original idea. And I says, what was your original idea? He said, I had an idea for a steel facade around the side of the building. And I really wanted to create the grid of the old Sophiatown. And I wanted people to go back and reclaim their slot. And we said, we're going to do that. So we did the unveil at Design Indaba. And so this is us as a social venture capitalist, beyond just doing a conference and being able to make this happen. And that was why Hugh Masekela came out of the shadows and played a trumpet solo. So this was it. And this was this emotionally charged morning when families went back. They hadn't been there for many years. And they were able to go back and take a selfie and reclaim their space on that particular block. So we think it should be a lever for economic growth. We showcase emerging creatives, which is fantastic. And the Graduate School of Business recently calculated that we've added 2.1 billion rand to the economy in 7 years. So creativity is not frothy. It's not frivolous. Creativity is capital. It's really, really to be valued. And what we're trying to do with the kinds of projects is to really make this a crucible for change. So we have a mantra, 3 days of talking, 362 days of doing. We're going to do that here too. 2 days of talking, 363 days of doing. So the corollary to a think tank is a do tank. That's so, so important. And we do a whole bunch of projects. Like, we've been fully sold out since 2004. We don't have to do a marketing campaign. So we thought about a problem that was existing in our city. And one is, there's this area called Monwabisi. There's quite a bit of a high incidence of violence against women. There's like one solitary tap servicing a whole host of people. There's no lighting in the transit to that solitary tap. And we thought, well, why don't we do some lights? And we did it in this kind of poetic way with a mural designer and interaction designer. And we built this massive mural on the highway in Cape Town. And then every single light on the mural represented a light in the townships. And it was a communications campaign, no logos, no branding, but it was something which really basically spoke to the challenges that exist in the township through a beautiful NGO called VPUU, Violence Prevention Through Urban Upgrade. And we use this to crowdfund a whole row of lights in this particular township. Gorgeous artist called Faith 47. So one light there represents the light in Monwebisi. So that's it, and I'm going to whip through this quickly because I want to introduce you to these fabulous folks. So we've done a low-cost housing project. We built a terrace of houses across Cape Town, which is pretty cool. We did this about 5 or 6 years ago. We've done a project which actually found its way to these shores as well. It was in Eindhoven, where we incentivized designers to leave this kind of model of B2B, business to business, or B2C, business to consumer, and ask about how about creative business to community? How about re-engaging with community? If I had to poll people in community, it says, who matters in your community? Where will a designer be? Maybe the first responder, the teacher, the doctor? Will the designer be 23rd or 55th? And we said that part of the problem is that maybe the designers have kind of left the public square. It's time to re-engage. And so we offered this competition where we said to people, get up early in the morning, remove the scales from your eyes, imagine you had a wand in your hand, walk down your street, and think of what intervention you could possibly do on your street to improve the quality of life. And it's now in 8 cities around the world. The most recent edition has been in Bergen. So it's a lot of fun. This is Violet's Walk in Cape Town, a system of furniture in the streets of Woodstock, named after this 90-year-old woman, Violet, which is so beautiful, you know. Design not in service of brand, design in service of people.